take her medicine when she was supposed to. My mother is 87 years old. This is my second mother. She's my stepmother. My mother died 48 years ago. And Metropolitan Community Church saw me through that day. And yesterday when I was in hospital, you know, of course, that thought crosses your mind. But I said, God, I know you got this. So each time, I was not afraid. I wasn't nervous. I wasn't upset. I said, okay, God's got
word says that we are overcome by the word of God and the testimonies that is in our mouth. We thank you for sealing this revival, not only in the people who have come and participated, but God, even on today, that our ears will hear and our hearts will receive, God, that you are still that God who is able to do what no other God can do. And God, we thank you that even now, right now, that you're going to lift up heavy hearts and heavy minds and heavy spirits in the name of Jesus. God, because we're serving a right now God who is able to move the mountains and to deliver us from every circumstances that are heavy on us. God, thank you for this witness today. And we thank you right now in advance for what you've already done. And we thank you for what you're going to do. And we thank you more importantly for what you're doing right now. Bless your name, oh God, for this life, for this new life, for this restored life, for a life of hope, a life of health, a life of joy and happiness. God, we thank you for it. We thank you for it. We thank you for it. God, I pray that you would comfort. Comfort the Snoop family. Comfort them in a way that only you can comfort them. Give them peace this day that surpasses all of their understanding. And God, not only for the things that I pray, but the things that are being prayed for every person under the sound of my voice, for those who are not even in this space but desire prayer, we lift them up to you today in Jesus' mighty name. And God, we'll give you the glory, we'll give you the honor, we'll continue to give you the praise because you are worthy of it, even in the midst of our storm. We thank you for the rainbow. We thank you for the rainbow. We thank you for the hope. We thank you for the newness. We thank you for that which is to come in Jesus' mighty name. And the church of God said, amen and amen and amen. Let me finish this week. It's one thing visitors and friends and even members who may not have physically experienced the revival. Sometimes it's important for you to hear the witness of your own faith community and to hear what they have received so that you will not know that it is just an individual experience, that God is moving by his spirit. And by the mere fact that you are here on today, everyone under the sound of our voice, God is still in our room, and God is still in the midst of us, and God is still able to give you the deliverance that is needed. We had a great service last weekend. Many folk were committed and recommitted themselves. And you're right, you heard a word from the Lord. May I say something to you? You all know that Pastor Perry has a discipline of time. Don't allow my frustration with Wednesday timelessness to confuse us with the blessing of the word. The word went forth. I'm just a disciplined person with time, and sometimes I am obsessed with folk. And the reason why is not because some preachers preach for an hour on Sunday. And that's okay. That's not the culture of our faith community. But my timelessness during the week is not for me because I'm a church boy. I know how to stay in church all night. And then get up in the morning and go back to work and then come back to church and stay again. See, Terry's service didn't start for us until 10 o'clock. So we didn't get out of church most of the time to 11:30 and midnight. Amen. And then we go find a chicken place and get a little something to eat. My concern with time during the week, because this culture don't come to church during the week. And I already know if you start off wrong, you won't come back the next day. Amen, lights. And so most of the time, I'm not going to worry about me. It's my concern about you. Because I know that I knew when you all were pulling at me so strong Wednesday night. You were pulling me. And I like, Pastor, I know you get ready to do something. And what am I going to do? And y'all were pulling at me, and y'all were pulling, and then y'all started sitting down on the word. So I was like, oh, God, in Jesus' name, help the people, Lord. Please let them end it. Not because because he was not preaching the word, because he did, it's just that I know y'all, and y'all wanted to hurry me get out of here. You want to be on, just like you all reflect on the love and the care and the concern of your pastor, I know my sheep, and I know when my sheep is getting restless. I know my sheep when they're getting sleepy. I know my sheep. I know when they say, okay, Reverend, it's time to go. I don't care how much hollering, how much whooping. I don't care how much shouting, how much dancing. It's time to go. I got to go to work in the morning. I came here from work. I ain't ate nothing. I'm still hungry. And we went to Hyde Park trying to find some. Pastor Eric and I were in Hyde Park, walking around in Hyde Park at 10:30 at night, trying to find something to eat. And every restaurant we went to, the kitchen was. And then he took me to some juke joint up there in Hyde Park. Oh, Jesus. And I'm still getting delivered from that. Yeah, pray my strength. Amen. So I understand that. So I had to say that because I don't want you to feel that that the word did not go forth, because it did. But my concern is for you, because I already know that even on Sunday morning at 12:15, there's a grumbling that happens in your stomach automatically that lets you know it's 12:15, it's almost brunch time, it's time to go. You can be shouting, dancing, preaching, hollering, singing, people crying, people testifying, but by 12:30, it's late for us. I know my sheep. But I also know my sheep to the degree that I don't want you to experience revival Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday and go back to the norm on Sunday. You can't come in here on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday and have high praise and worship and have high energy and praise and then come back on Sunday and allow the enemy to steal your joy and say, we're back to the norm. The devil is a liar. You can't come back because God has spoken, God has delivered, God has allowed his power to be released in this place, and it's not over yet. And I don't want you to allow tradition or the order of service on Sunday to rob you from what that God has in store for you for the rest of your life. Just like God did it last week, there will be another revival this coming week. It may not be at 4610, but it'll be right where you are. It may be in your car, it may be in your home, it may be on your job, but you've got to understand that every day that God wakes us up is another opportunity to get it right all over again. It's revival time. You've heard the term on Wednesday, what revival is, and without God, there is no revival. It's not the work of the pastor. It's not the work of the evangelist. It's not the work of the deacons. Revival is the work of God. And when God starts reviving us and renewing us, there's no way that we can turn back and look back. You're right. There are some things that God has loosed you from this week. There are some people that God has loosed you from this week. Don't you dare allow somebody to rob that which God has planted within you. Don't you dare allow someone to take back that which God has already promised you. It's your season and it is your time. The only reason why many of us don't embellish our season is because of fear. And you're right, Deacon Janice, we're so afraid of what somebody's going to think and somebody's going to say. But you're walking around unhappy. You're walking around burdened. And you're walking around sad. And God said, I'm the one that gives you life, and I'm the one who can give you the joy. I'm the one that gives you life, and I'm the one who can restore you. I'm the one that gives you life, and I'm the one that keeps you. And I'm the only one that you have to answer to. There is evidence of the revival this week. And the evidence of the revival has been from the word of the testimony of those of you who have shared. When a man, I did a wedding yesterday, when a man marries a woman and a woman marries a man, there is some evidence that there is, that they're married. People who are married, you ought to have evidence that you're married. Amen, somebody. People who walk up to Jesus, I didn't even know you were married. No. There ought to be some evidence. Amen. You can't go out in the club and they don't know that you're married. You can't turn your ring around or put your ring up. Amen. There ought to be some evidence. Amen. And you know what? There ought to be some evidence today that you've been to church all week. No. So you mean to tell me the only way you can shout high praise is during the week when somebody else come in here and tell you, let me hear you shout? Some of y'all ain't high praised it yet. So you mean to tell me the only way we can come and give high praise in Metropolitan is when we have revival? Is there anybody in here who can give evidence that the Holy Ghost showed up and showed out? No. Is there anybody who don't mind giving a high praise right now? Hallelujah. You can have your seat now. But I believe that there ought to be some evidence that we've been in revival all week. The sound of revival ought to be in the room. The joy of revival ought to be in the room. The happiness of revival ought to be in the room. Your body may be tired from being out all week, but your joy and your soul ought to be restored. Somebody who didn't attend revival, sitting next to you or on your aisle, ought to have some evidence that they were in revival. And because they were in revival, I'm going to receive a revival touch because I'm sitting right next to the power house right now. You ought to shout glory. I've determined in my mind that I don't need no guest pastor to come in here during the week and for me to return on Sunday and act like I ain't heard nothing Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday. God gave us a word, and the word wasn't for last week. He's the same God last week, today, and forevermore. When you've been revived, you got a new attitude. When you've been revived, you have a different mental position toward other people. Mary E. couldn't be in revival in here and didn't go home and do what the preacher offered for all of us to do. That revived people are forgiving people. Amen, somebody. Oh, no. I mean for real forgiving people. And you can't wait until you get ready. Well, we're going to see when it happens. I don't know. No, you got to do it right then and there. Because the Bible tells us not to go to bed angry. We ought not to let the sun come down until we have resolved everything, and especially in your household. Amen, somebody. And so therefore, you have to do that. And many of us are struggling through trials, still trying to forgive. Don't struggle, just let it go. So revived people have a new attitude toward others. And not only do you have a new attitude toward others, but you're right, you have a different opinion and a different view of God himself. Because you allow yourself to know during revival that God is not allowing you to go through the storm by yourself, but he's going to bring you out. And at the end of the storm, God has got a rainbow with your name on it. Hallelujah, somebody. And I don't know about you, but I want a big rainbow. I don't know about you, but I want a big, large, colorful rainbow. So that means that you got to go through some more things. But don't understand that even though you're going through, but that's not all of your life. Your life is not summed up of what you're going through. Your life is more summed up of what you're coming out of. And what you're coming out of is going to make you a greater and a better person for the glory of God and for humankind. When you've been revived, you
than just a force of power for a week. You become less distant and become more personable. But then you will go to him in trouble. He's the one. And when Pastor Harris was preaching and teaching and ministering on Friday about peace, many of us, God has already delivered us. We just haven't accepted it. He's already given us the breakthrough. We just don't receive it. And more importantly, it's the enemy that comes to destroy the mind. The enemy don't want the body. He can get anybody to serve him, but he wants the mind. Hallelujah. And many of us, the reason why we cannot focus and receive what God has for us, because our mind is so cluttered and our mind would not allow us to believe that God really loves you just the way you are. But he loves us enough where we are to change us from where we are to where he wants us to be. I thank God for that kind of loving God. But God wants us to have peace, because the only way we can have peace, the only way we can function and receive the fullness of God is that you've got to believe that God is working in your life, and the enemy is just trying to mess up your mind. When you've been revived, go to him in trouble. No distance, more personable, loving, forgiving. But you know what I want to say to you? The other thing is, you have a different mentality, not only for yourself, but toward other people, and especially those who co-labor with you in the ministry of a great God. When you have been revived, you understand, you have a sensitivity to those who are lost, because you want them to receive the same kind of life and the joy that you have. This joy is not joy unless you give it away. Love is not love unless you give it away. Grace is not grace unless you give it away. We have to do what God has done for us. We have to do to others. I'm just giving us a summary of what revival and the evidence of revival ought to be for us. We have to hold on, because you know what? You know how you have the high experiences? You have a high revival, you have this high experience, and then you have a good time. You know, you have a good time at a gathering, you have a good time at a scenario, and then it comes down. And many times, you have your anniversary celebrations and your birthday celebrations, but now it's time to go home. And then you open the door and it's same old, like, Lord, wow. And it's difficult to preach and teach after main holy days, after Easter. That Sunday, you give it to the associate. Let them work it out. The folk come in here that was last Sunday. Easter Sunday, he lives, Christ Jesus lives. Are you with me? Everybody got their bonnets on, everybody excited, everybody, all the kids all. And then the second Sunday after Easter, Christmas, everybody got bags, red, green, and white bags, and walking around. Merry Christmas, the second Sunday after Easter. First Sunday of New Year, Happy New Year, hallelujah. Second Sunday, revival, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, that Friday night, Sunday, Pastor, we tired today. But you got to hold on to the best that you own. Come on, somebody. Because when you revive, you have new enthusiasm. Don't you dare think that Pastor don't experience those moments as well. I had revival all week.